based on for sunshine, your worship leaders this morning. Is that better? Is that better?
Yes.
Great, thank you. Well, welcome this morning to worship at Ralph Connor Memorial United Church in our Canmore location. And what a beautiful morning it is with that mist. I just looked out this morning and the mountains were peeking through the mist, and so grateful for the rain and the clear air compared to other areas that are getting a lot of smoke. Whether you are here from Canmore or Banff, from elsewhere in the Bow Valley or elsewhere in the world, we hope you will find a place of welcome with us today. And if you feel comfortable standing and introducing yourself, let us know where you're from. Please do. You never know, there probably aren't many degrees of separation between us. So are there any visitors this morning that would like to stand?
I'm Darrell, this is Gail, we're from Calgary. We've been here before.
Well, welcome back. I have a quick story. My husband and I were just recently in Berlin in a laundromat. And of course, we could not figure out how to use the laundromat. It was all in German. And a young man came along who was in the laundromat, and he said, "Well, I have an app and I'll help you with it." And so he did. And afterwards I said, "Oh, are you visiting or do you live here in Berlin?" Anyhow, it turned out that he was from Alberta, Calgary. So there you go.
That's
you're all invited to stay for, to go to Gordon Hall just through these doors here for coffee and tea and goodies and conversation after the service. And I would be amiss to not also wish everyone here a happy Father's Day to those fathers in the group. I hope you had breakfast in bed. No. But I made him breakfast. Well, the clipboard today will be going around next week because there isn't a sheep for July, so you're off the hook today. But please keep in mind that we appreciate and need your help to make these services work. Okay, very good. All right, and now we're going to receive the Christ candle. And we know that Christ is with us at all times and in all places. In worship, we signify that by receiving the Christ candle. And from that candle, we light a peace candle, which expresses our hope for peace in the world, a peace founded in justice and in the equal sharing of resources. And our opening hymn today is The Church's One Foundation, and it doesn't have the number on my page either. 331. And it's verses 1, 2, 4, and 5.
Our God.
Ralph Connor United Church is located within Treaty 7 region of southern Alberta, the traditional Treaty 7 territory and oral practices of the Stoney Nakoda, comprised of the Bearspaw First Nation, Chiniki First Nation, and Good Stoney First Nations, as well as the Tsuut'ina First Nations and the Blackfoot Confederacy, comprised of the Siksika, Piikani, and Kainai. We acknowledge that this territory is home to the Métis Nation of Alberta, Region 3, within the historical Northwest Métis homeland. We acknowledge all nations who live, work, and play, and help us steward this land, and honor and celebrate this territory. We commit to working to live in right relations and to advance truth and reconciliation. In the same way that Jesus reached out to all people, our faith community is called to be open and inclusive. As a congregation residing on Treaty 7 lands, we continue to seek ways to be inclusive of all people of the Bow Valley, regardless of gender, sexual orientation, age, cultural background, education, level, mobility challenges, all people. We are delighted that both Ralph Connor and Rundle Memorial United Church, Banff, went through the affirming process so our amalgamated community of faith in Banff, Canmore is an affirming ministry of the United Church of Canada. Within and alongside our affirming commitments, we are actively engaged in living into right relations with our Indigenous hosts on this land. See our Right Relations page for more information. To learn more about our strivings to be a place of safety and inclusion, please go to our Affirming Ministry page.
Holy Trinity, this hour set us free to worship. Amen. Before we hear the scripture reading this morning, I invite you to take a moment, a time of quiet reflection, following that prayer, share together a chant while we're seated.
Gail and Barnicot are here. They were congregants of mine in Calgary for 36 years. And they come up every year when I'm here. I thought they would have had enough. It's joy to have you here. But seeing you there reminds me of an event that happened in Central's history that you will know and remember with me. Many years ago, our ancient boiler died. That one. We were entering fall. It was already feeling a bit cool. People were, of course, wondering what we were going to do. It was a massive, majorly expensive undertaking. In the middle of hearing all that we would have to do to mitigate, and you know, I said maybe we shouldn't replace it. They all looked at me like, what? I thought about it further, and I, one day during a sermon, I said that to the people. I said, if we didn't replace our boiler, and we had to shut this place down, what would happen to us as a congregation? Could we survive? And they all looked at me like, you're kidding, right? Well, we'd done it once, the fire of 1916 that had absolutely gutted the church, nothing but a shell. They faced the same question about the future. It was not an easy decision for them to make back in those days. Devastating fire. The paper said that the entire congregation was turned into the street, their words. Imagine feeling that. Turned into the street. What now? Where do we go? They debated whether to rebuild. They found temporary relocations. The old Herald building, the office space, the Grand Theater became the worship center. It was something. And then they debated whether they wanted to take another mortgage for the sum of $45,000. Rebuild this huge building. Imagine. Imagine. They wondered. I made me wonder though, would it destroy the church if we didn't have a building? It's not a bad question to wrestle with a bit, I think, at times as congregations. Is the church more than a location, a familiar address for us? What is the church after all, friends? What is it at its essence? What makes it relevant? Well, today in Acts, we read, Don read us a brief passage, which gives us the very first glimpse into the life of the primitive church. The first portrait, verse 44 that we heard read, it says simply this, all the believers were together and had everything in common, period. All the believers were together and had everything in common. I want to show you a gift, something very precious to me and special. That's why it's sitting here. And again, Norm and I have a connection here through this. When I retired, a member of the congregation and a friend of mine who was the owner of the exclusive men's store, James and Dixon, Terry Mullen, presented me with this quilt. It's very unique and special, and I brought it along to show you this morning. This was made out of remnants of scraps of material, castaway scraps that his tailor Vince carefully sewed together to make this amazing pattern out of all this cloth. Italian wool, Irish linen, stitched together in this quilt, one of a kind. And he presented it to me. So I brought it along because out of the useless scraps, he created an incredibly beautiful and memorable piece of art, a treasure. I brought it with me to remind us of what happens when we commit our lives to Jesus Christ. Not only do we receive something as individuals, we receive new life through a relationship with Him, but He takes us, each of us, like one of these fabric pieces, beautiful in itself. He takes us, each so uniquely different from the other, with all our flaws and feelings of uselessness at times, and binds us together in a beautiful and serviceable living quilt of community, something that we can never realize alone. I think a quilt is a perfect image of the church, friends. It reminds me I cannot relate to God by myself. God lives and expresses God's self through our togetherness. Through our togetherness. The scripture said all the believers were together. It mentions together, I think, five times in those few verses. There's a reason for that, a message that we have to get. and had everything in common, for many the one. Now, if you look at this quote closely, and please do afterwards if you want, you see it's obviously stitched and woven together with thread. But actually, the thread is used to form two patterns here in this quilt. There's the obvious stitching that connects the individual pieces together, the patches together. But if you look closely, you will see that he has added another stitching pattern here, one that crisscrosses and forms its own design with and through all the various patches. Very intricate and beautiful. A whole other depth and reality to this quilt. And that stands out for me as important. It creates a relief of its own, which makes the whole thing much more interesting and appealing. A common thread, if you will, which for us is Jesus Christ, who creates his own pattern with us all individually. But only when we're joined together, it's beautiful and reveals his presence, his love, his life, the one thing we all share in common, the pattern and presence of his life. Well, I believe the church that gets it all together is the church that shares a common life. In this, we're all together. All together. You know that old song, The More We Get Together? Right? What's it say?
The happier we'll be.
Absolutely. And please remember that. The happier we'll be, right? The more we get together. Isn't that? We come most fully alive, we're most vital, only when we're more deeply connected with one another. To the contrary, unfortunately, when we fail to find a connection with even a few other souls, life is diminished. Life is detrimental to flourishing and even survival. We had a member of our staff for several years, Chris, who oversaw our children's ministry. Chris came to a staff meeting one day and told us she was really disturbed that she hadn't been able to contact her father for 6 months. Now, her dad was a loner. He had a kind of nomadic life. He had a home. He lived in Kelowna, an apartment. Few friends. Traveled from fall to spring. She would never hear from him until spring when he got back to his home. But this year she had not heard from him. But she was worried. Few relationships. Well, suggested she phone the police in Kelowna, the RCMP, and she did. And when they finally got into his apartment, they checked with any of his contacts who hadn't seen him. Nobody in the building had seen him. They went in, and he had been dead for 4 months. They estimated. Alone. Disconnected. I flew out quickly to be with them because I didn't want them to feel alone. They were part of the church. You know, in many places today, folks, such a tragic loss of friendship, neighborliness, and community. People are starving for real human relationship and authentic community. I think one of the need-meeting reasons Jesus established the church is for that. Yet we live in a time when more and more Christians are separating, believing from belonging. Believing from belonging. I saw a poll some time ago that said 75% of people that were surveyed didn't connect faith with being active in a community of faith. And that's growing, especially after COVID. It's pretty much God and me for so many, too many, I believe. Yet throughout Scripture, believing and belonging are always connected. Always. That's not about sharing life even just with a chosen few of my preference, but everyone in the quilt is included. You see, I made a discovery for my life. You don't have to hang out for too long with most of you to know and me to know that Christians bring their stuff into the community, right? We do. We bring it all. The good, bad, and ugly. It's just like a beloved quilt over time. If it's used, it could be tattered and worn and frayed in places. It happens to all of us. I read a story of an Anglican priest. He wrote this story about a parishioner he hadn't seen in church in a while. And he was quite concerned about her. And she had rarely missed before. And she just vanished without a word. Nobody knew what happened to her. So he got in touch with her and he took her to lunch. And he asked her how she was and was there something she wanted to tell him about why she wasn't around. And she said, "I'm having a crisis of faith." And he said, "Well, how's that going for you?" She said, "Not very well." But then he said something brilliant. He said this, he said, "Maybe you should try having your crisis of faith in church with the rest of us." Isn't that great? I'm sure you'll find you're not alone. Oh, there you go. It's not about having it all together, like in we have it all together, but it's about being all together regardless. You're part of the quilt, you are part of the quilt. Jesus' community is not one we might have chosen for him. It's not ours to choose. It's whom God has drawn and placed here with all our torn and worn out places. I get it together when I get with you all together. Together in a shared life and together in a shared love. That's most important. You. You know, I sensed here the first Sunday, this is my seventh summer here with you. Believe it or not. I sensed on my first Sunday here a deep caring, a devotion to one another. It spoke without words. You know, being a great church isn't only about fulfilling the Great Commission, but the Great Commandment. Most learning to share life and love. It's about us growing to love one another as Jesus loves us. I need to love you as Jesus has loved me. Period. Fulfilling the Great Commandment can't happen in isolation or at a distance. It's up close and personal. So never take for granted what you have as a congregation. You know, the first Christians were sitting. One of the things that people outside said of them is see how they love one another. See how they love one another. Something jumped out at them about that element of life. It's together in life. It's together in love. Love gives a lift. I always say love gives a lift. It never gives a load. It never gives a load. You feel a load when you meet with someone or spend time with them. That has nothing to do with love. What does love look like, sound like? Appreciation, affirmation, encouragement for starts. Doesn't take long in life for our self-esteem to be hammered, to feel picked on and picked apart. Now who among us doesn't have a crystal clear recall of times when our deficiencies are pointed out, loaded down under the weight of criticism? The church is the one place we should always get a lift with love. Always. It's Father's Day. I remember the story of a little boy who said to his dad, "Dad, let's play darts. I'll throw the dart and you say, terrific." We all need to know how we're wonderful. We make a difference. I'm here today because I grew up in a church where people would pronounce and demonstrate God's future hope for my life. My love and their love for me. Dave Ross was my fifth grade Sunday school teacher. We were all boys' classes back in those old days, some of you remember. boys' class. Dave Ross was our teacher. I could not tell you one thing he said. I can tell you he loved me. And that's what impressed me, and I never forgot him. When I preached my first sermon after ordination in my home church, he was beaming in the front row. Dave Ross is one reason I'm here today. He gave me a lift and a load. Now love lifts us up when it is a love that serves others. We know this. Alone, I'm consumed by a little world. When I get together in community, I see the larger needs of a group, and they become as important as God. And when that happens, it blesses God. It says in our reading, they were selling their possessions and goods. They gave them to anyone who had need. Anyone who had need. That's not human, that's supernatural love. Together in life, together in love, together in a shared legacy to our communities. That matters. The verse that really grabs my attention in what was read earlier is the last verse. It says, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of or favor of all the people. Now listen to that. And each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. The impact of that life and love was a legacy to the community. Enjoying the goodwill or favor of all the people around them. Something to pray for. They enjoyed the favor of all the people. Staggering. They knew and favored their neighbors. Their love naturally overflowed beyond themselves. They shared everything they had with whoever was in need. They immersed themselves in their community and its needs. Daily they met. Daily God increased to their numbers. They shared a purpose, a great commission fulfilled through a community that truly lived out the great commandment. They shared their life and their love. They lived transformed lives, and God brought them together, all together, as God has brought us all together to share that common life, common love, and common purpose because of Jesus Christ, our common thread. We sing again.
Yeah.
to join with me. God makes peace within us. Let us claim it. God makes peace among us. Let us share it. Let us greet one another as a sign of God's peace. Peace of Christ be with you. Peace. We need you.
in your ways. Out of gratitude for your care, we bring our gifts before you. Use them for your work of caring, that all may feast at the table of abundance, walk without fear, and drink deeply from the cup of compassion. Amen.
Possibly before then, if he finds himself exhausted or if we wear him out. so that the council has said we need a futures exploration, a chance for us in this congregation to kind of develop our capacity to read the signs of the time and think about the alternative futures that we face. Because not now, but in a year and a bit, we're going to have to be able to declare to ourselves what we are up for and whom it is that we call. And so there, a little group of us, Jordan, Matt, and Sim, and I have been tasked to put together a program that would enable us to explore the future, not just of this congregation, but of the Bow Valley. Because just as the early church lived its life, what we heard in Acts in Jerusalem, it would be slightly different if they were in Corinth. It would be slightly different if they were in another place. And therefore, what the Bow Valley becomes is part of what we need to take into account. And we as a group need to try some ideas on you. We need some of you to understand what we're up to and to be able to respond to us to say, hey, that's exciting, or don't touch that. Go back to the drawing board. And Wednesday at 1:30 in Gordon Hall, there will be an hour where we'll present the ideas we're working with, how we're going about it, and we'd love your feedback. We need some of you to understand what we're about so that you can coach us and that we avoid somewhere down the road when we're ready to launch something next fall. People say, why didn't you tell us about it? The other thing is Thursday night at 7, there's a Zoom call. So if you don't want to come in person or aren't able to make it on Wednesday afternoon, join us by Zoom and we will do essentially the same thing by Zoom. And we'll also make a video of that we'll make available on the website so that you can see it at your own convenience if you can't make either of those. Thank you.
Any other announcements?
Yes, I would also add my support for that kind of a process. And I thought of a quote Dr. Nelson Mercer, who was predecessor of my central, said, God always calls from the future.
Yes.
And I love that. So God is calling you from tomorrow, and all your tomorrow, so time to focus in on that and join together. That's a wonderful thing to do for this congregation. I submit on that. Well, please join me in our commissioning benediction. We leave this place not as people who have all the answers.
We leave this place not as people who are holier than others.
We leave this place as people who've been shown a grace, a calling, and a Savior who has changed our lives forever.
Yes.